A few weeks ago, I investigated bug zappers as a way to protect myself from the millions of mosquitoes swarming in my backyard this summer, but we decided that kind of device probably wasn't worth the investment. So I guess now it's time to explore all of the various options for chemical mosquito repellents. Which ones actually work? Which is the best? And are these chemicals bad for us? First, we need to address that word. Yeah, that one. Lots of people use chemicals like a swear word, with the implied dichotomy that chemicals are artificial and therefore bad, while anything else is natural and therefore good. And then there's the inevitable argument on social media about how
everything is made out of chemicals. That's how matter works.
And
well, cyanide is natural, but that doesn't make it good for you.
So yeah, I'm gonna use the word chemicals to refer to some substances in this video, but that word does not actually imply anything about their quality or safety. We good? Okay, moving on. When we talk about mosquito repellents, they really come in two types: synthetically derived chemicals and essential oils extracted from plants. There's also one specific repellent that sort of falls into both categories, but we'll get to that in a moment. Wait your turn! We can start with the synthetically derived repellents, because I'm sure you want me to address the proverbial elephant in the room, DDT. DDT was used around the world in the 40s and 50s for all sorts of pest insect control, including being sprayed in neighborhoods in the United States to kill mosquitoes. This actually makes it more of an insecticide than a mosquito repellent, but it ties into the rest of the story, so bear with me. If you have heard of DDT before, it's probably been in a super negative context, though. After the publication of Rachel Carson's book Silent Spring and subsequent studies demonstrating dangerous human health effects, detrimental environmental effects, and pest insect resistance, DDT use dramatically decreased in the US, with an effective total ban by 1985. It's still used in some other countries like India and North Korea, where insect-transmitted diseases are a major health concern. Why am I bringing this up? Well, because there was another insect repellent developed alongside DDT in the 1940s, and it may have become a victim of guilt by association with DDT. I'm talking, of course, about DEET. I guess it doesn't help that their names sound similar. Anyway, DEET has gotten a bit of a negative reputation with the general public, probably because it's a chemical associated with DDT, and also because of some scattered reports of negative human health effects. I've linked some interesting papers below that detail some of those potential health effects, but there are also some caveats here. First, while between 10 to 50% of a topical dose of DEET is absorbed through the skin into the body, it's also very quickly expressed out of us by our body's filtration systems, so it's not even a concern for pregnant women to use, whereas some mosquito-borne illnesses can be very bad for pregnant women and their little passengers. Secondly, toxicity reports for DEET are often conflated with other things happening to a person. For example, toxicity might be underreported because doctors don't always ask about DEET exposure when treating patients, but on the flip side, toxicity-related seizures in children might be overreported because seizure disorders are more common in children regardless of exposure to chemicals like DEET. And thirdly, many of the reports of harmful effects of DEET come as a result of improper use. So don't, like, spray it in your eyes. I can't believe I have to say that, but there it is. You might also want to wash it off your skin when you're done being outside, and don't layer it with sunscreen. Although, if you're going to be spending time outside, you should probably be protected against both the sun and biting insects. All of the debate over the health effects of DEET does mean that it's been restricted in some places, including in Canada, where you can't buy products with a greater than 30% concentration of DEET. However, even a low concentration can still protect you from biting insects for up to 8 hours. And yeah, I would much rather have DEET on my skin than get infected with malaria, or West Nile virus, or Zika, or yellow fever, or elephantiasis, or dengue fever, or encephalitis, or tularemia, or... But say you wanted to try repelling mosquitoes with something a little more floral? Get out of here! Plant-based insect repellents are comprised of essential oils that deter mosquitoes from biting. What are essential oils? Well, they're basically extra or secondary chemicals created by plants, and they're usually pretty complex and volatile compounds. Over 3,000 essential oils have been identified, but only about 300, so one-tenth, of these are currently used for pharmaceuticals, perfumes, and other cosmetics. Secondary plant compounds normally function to protect plants from fungal pathogens, insects, and even vertebrate herbivores, but we can try to use them to protect ourselves from mosquitoes. The most well-known plant-based insect repellent is citronella oil. This comes from plants in the Cymbopogon genus, aka lemongrass. The essential oil can be sprayed on your skin or added to a candle, but either way, it will protect you from mosquitoes for approximately 2 hours before you need to reapply. I've posted links to a few articles I found exploring other essential oil insect repellents. Some studies in India showed that pure peppermint oil and pure pine oil could provide 6 to 11 or 9 to 11 hours of protection for mosquitoes, respectively. However, the researchers did note that some of the human baits had to be removed from the experiment because they developed allergic reactions to the essential oils on their skin. So that just goes to show that natural doesn't always mean harmless. Oh yeah, have you ever wondered how mosquito repellents are tested? The tests normally start in a lab, but may eventually be moved to the field, as in the case of the research from India that I just mentioned. The candidate chemicals are sprayed on living humans, who then either stick their arm in a box or sit in a room. In either case, the box or the room is filled with hungry female mosquitoes. Not the kind of research I'd sign up for, just saying. Another set of tests in Korea showed that the essential oil in the herb thyme can repel mosquitoes for up to an hour. In this particular test, thyme actually did better than DEET, but I have to question how they got that result, considering that most tests show DEET working for multiple hours. And yet another study compared several essential oils against one another. Basil oil alone worked for 3 hours and for 6.5 hours with added vanillin. Turmeric oil alone worked for 1 hour and for 4.5 hours with vanillin. And kefir lime oil worked for 1 hour alone and for 3 hours with vanillin. What's vanillin? It's another essential oil that, when combined with some of the candidates for mosquito repellents, increases the power of the volatiles, allowing them to repel bugs more effectively and for longer amounts of time. But wait, there are even more essential oils that some people think might make good insect repellents. I wasn't able to find specific research on any of these, but the list includes soybean, cedar, verbena, pennyroyal, geranium, lavender, kejaput, cinnamon, rosemary, allspice, garlic, clove, catnip, eucalyptus, licorice, and oil from the neem tree. At the very least, if you tried any of these, you'd probably smell delicious. It's worth noting that different species of mosquitoes respond differently to different volatile oils. For instance, some oils might be really effective against one species, but completely ineffective against most of the others, meaning that there might not be one essential oil insect repellent that works everywhere all the time. We should also remember that all mosquito repellent solutions are currently topical, meaning they have to be applied to your skin. We don't yet have a pill that will just change your body chemistry to make you less attractive to mosquitoes. Topical applications is especially important when thinking about essential oils because the oils need to volatilize or evaporate off of your skin into the air around you in order to be effective. This doesn't happen if you just plant citronella or lavender in your garden, so they won't repel mosquitoes. I did mention that there's one insect repellent that sort of straddles the line between synthetic chemicals and essential oils, and it's probably my favorite way to protect myself from insect bites. Pyrethrum is a chemical that can be extracted from chrysanthemum flowers, and it's a powerful repellent and insecticide. Permethrin is a synthetic mimic of pyrethrum, and you can buy it in many outdoor gear stores. Differently from all of the other repellents I've mentioned, you shouldn't apply permethrin to your skin. Rather, you spray it onto your clothes, where it will stay and be effective for several weeks, even if you wash those clothes. I've found permethrin to be incredibly effective against mosquitoes, and also against ticks, mites, and other arthropods that you'd really prefer didn't invade your personal space. It's also very safe as long as you use it correctly. So applying permethrin to your clothes and DEET or some other insect repellent to your skin will hopefully keep you protected while you're outside. So what do you think about the debate between chemical and natural products? Keeping in mind that repellents based on essential oils are often synthetic versions of those plant chemicals. What insect repellent do you prefer to use? I'd love to hear your thoughts down in the comments. If you liked this video, don't forget to like it. If you didn't like this video, please share it it with someone who would. And if you'd like to support the Roving Naturalist, remember to hit the subscribe button and the bell notification icon. Then go check out our Patreon page. You can also follow me on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. My science-themed Dungeons & Dragons game, Nature Check, will be performing live in the Urban Chestnut Brewing Company's Grove Beer Hall location in St. Louis in November. So if you're in the area, please come hang out with us. And as always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.